From the JAMA Network, this is the JAMA Medical News Podcast, discussing timely topics in clinical medicine, biomedical sciences, public health, and health policy, featured in the medical news section of JAMA.
I'm Kate Schweitzer for JAMA Medical News. We're bringing you a special episode about a study published in JAMA last year that's been receiving a tremendous amount of attention in recent days. The study's focus was on acetaminophen use during pregnancy and children's risk of autism and other neurodevelopmental disorders. It's come into the spotlight after the U.S. Food and Drug Administration issued an alert to physicians nationwide that the use of acetaminophen by pregnant women may be linked to an increased risk of neurological conditions, such as autism and ADHD, in their children. The FDA also initiated the process for a label change to products containing acetaminophen, most notably Tylenol, which remains the only over-the-counter medication approved for treating fevers in pregnancy. Although the FDA acknowledged that a causal relationship has not been established, it suggested that clinicians should consider minimizing the use of acetaminophen during pregnancy for routine, low-grade fevers. The same day, President Donald Trump urged pregnant women not to take Tylenol at a press conference. Following these developments, the World Health Organization issued a statement emphasizing that while extensive research has been undertaken over the past decade, including large-scale studies that look into the links between acetaminophen use during pregnancy and autism, no consistent association has been found. Last year's study in JAMA is among the most recent to investigate this question. The researchers followed 2.5 million children in Sweden, born in 1995 through 2019. They used sibling controls to account for genetic and other environmental confounders, and they found no increased risk in autism, ADHD, or intellectual disabilities in children of women who used acetaminophen during pregnancy. To get some clarity on this issue, JAMA Deputy Editor Dr. Linda Brubaker, who is an obstetrician-gynecologist, and editor-in-chief of the newly launched channel JAMA Plus Women's Health, spoke with Dr. Brian Lee, the senior author on this paper. Dr. Lee is a professor of epidemiology at Drexel University Dornsife School of Public Health. The two discussed his study findings and methods, what other researchers have found, and how discouraging acetaminophen use during pregnancy could affect patient care.
Dr. Lee, thank you for joining me today. General clinical guidance has always been to use medication cautiously during pregnancy for effective treatment of fever or pain, both of which are clear indications for the use of acetaminophen during pregnancy. Yet there have been conflicting reports on whether acetaminophen use during pregnancy increases the risk of neurodevelopmental disorders. I'd like you to start by pointing out what your study published in JAMA in 2024, what were the major findings?
Thank you, Dr. Brubaker, for having me. Our study conducted in Sweden looked at 2.5 million pregnancies, the mothers and their children followed for over 20 years. And we were able to do this using the National Computerized Registers system. What we found, it's actually a two-part story. The first part is that when we looked at the children born to mothers who used acetaminophen during pregnancy, and compared them to the children born to mothers who didn't use acetaminophen, we saw an apparent statistical association between acetaminophen use and risk of autism, ADHD, and intellectual disability. But association is not causation. And so the second part of our story is that we wanted to test out if this association was causal. These mothers who use acetaminophen are different in many ways from mothers who don't use acetaminophen. As you mentioned, there are indications for use, headaches, infections, fevers, things that have been plausibly associated with autism and other conditions in the past. And these things are what we call confounders, a third factor that might explain an association. One of the examples I use in the classroom to explain confounding is eating ice cream and risk of drowning. And the idea here is that ice cream is statistically associated with risk of drowning, but this is not a causal association. It is actually hot weather that increases ice cream consumption, as well as increases likelihood of swimming, which would increase likelihood of drowning. So we wanted to test whether this statistical association was real or not. And the way we did this was that we did a sibling control analysis. Basically, we compare within the same parents, siblings where one was exposed to acetaminophen in the womb and one was not. And the reason for doing this is because, well, there's a couple different reasons, but one of the biggest elephants in the room when it comes to confounding is genetics. For neurodevelopmental disorders especially, they are highly heritable, and genetics comprises a substantial proportion of their cause. So studies that don't take into account genetics may come to different conclusions than studies who do take into account genetics. When we do the sibling control analyses, all of the statistical associations completely disappeared. In other words, the associations did not appear to be causal.
Could I ask a couple questions about the study design? You went out of your way to try to design a study that was very, very rigorous. And we typically think of randomized controlled trials as generating the highest level of evidence. That's not really possible or feasible for this research question. But what other elements did you and your co-authors do to really make the study design as rigorous as possible?
Right. You're referencing the point that it is difficult to conduct an ethical randomized controlled trial of pregnant women, and especially for these neurodevelopmental disorders, follow them up for many, many years, right? It's very difficult to do that. So in terms of the rigor of what we tried to do, there's a couple different things. So first of all, thanks to the health register system, we had comprehensive medical history on the mothers and the fathers, as well as the kids themselves. And this is extremely important because, as I mentioned before, the indications for acetaminophen use could confound. So we have data on things like infections. We have data on things like rheumatoid arthritis, which might increase pain. So things like this. We have cutting-edge statistical methods where we are able to control for these sorts of confounders. One of the things I'll mention is that our exposure assessment is always something to ask about, because how do you ascertain a mother's acetaminophen use during pregnancy? You know, studies that look at this retrospectively are going to have a challenge, because if you ask someone, oh, what did you take for pain 10 years ago? It's going to be very difficult. Our study had the advantage of being prospectively collected. So in other words, these data on acetaminophen use were collected at the time of pregnancy. So it was less likely to have recall issues.
Not only did you collect prospective exposure, you were also able to get some information about dose responsiveness.
Yes, yes. So acetaminophen is a medication that can be offered over the counter as well as through prescription. And what we did have available to us was all prescription drug records at a certain point in time. And so we were able to, for a subsample of the analysis, look at dose response. And I think this is a very clarifying analysis, because dose response is traditionally used as a marker of causality. If something causes an outcome, in theory, more of that exposure should cause more of that outcome, right? And so we were able to test this out in our analysis as well.
Now, other studies have found associations between acetaminophen during pregnancy and autism. And why might the results from this study differ from those other studies that report association?
That's an excellent question. There have been, according to a recent review, 46 different studies that have examined acetaminophen use during pregnancy and neurodevelopmental outcomes. And there may be more out there, but the evidence is inconsistent. Studies have shown associations with outcomes like ADHD and autism. Other studies have not. The trend that seems to emerge is that the studies that have better control of potential confounders, especially those who do sibling analyses, tend to find no evidence to support a causal association.
So how will the evidence from this study help patients and their clinicians consider the risks of judicious acetaminophen use in pregnancy?
The traditional way to think about medication use is lowest dose possible for the shortest duration possible. And I don't think this study changes any of that, and certainly not any of the messaging from the administration. I think what our study does add is evidence to alleviate a mother's concern that taking this medication might be somehow harmful. We had such a comprehensive data set and such a large sample that inconsistencies due to small sample size variation or inability to control for potential biases, you know, we were able to do a lot of this. Now, I'm not going to claim that our study is perfect, but I think it certainly adds a strong measure of evidence to allay any potential concerns.
You and your co-authors outlined several limitations to this study. Could you just briefly summarize those?
Yeah. So the first and foremost thing, as we discussed earlier, is that this is not a randomized controlled trial, right? And so that's usually our gold standard of evidence. And so because we don't meet that high bar, there's potentially more issues. But of course, the same can be said for every single study on this topic, because there are no randomized controlled trials on this topic. And so that's one major limitation. The second, I think, is that with any observational study, you run the risk of apples to oranges comparisons, right? Just namely, the people who are exposed are apples and the people who are unexposed are oranges. And you're comparing these two completely different fruits. And so the way that we did address that issue was to do the sibling controls and to get more of that apples to apples comparison. But it's, of course, not going to be perfect like a randomized controlled trial might be. So there's that. One of the limitations that we also address is that acetaminophen use in Sweden is lower during our study period than other places around the world. So some critiques of our work have indicated that, 70% of pregnant women use acetaminophen during pregnancy. And while that figure might be true for certain samples, there seems to be a tremendous amount of variation depending on which study sample or which time period you're looking at. I think in general, the opponents of our work have mentioned that, because the exposure or the use of acetaminophen was so low in the study that this could not be valid. And so our use in our population was 7.5% on average over the study period. And so in contrast, for example, a U.S. study showed between 50 to 70%, another U.S. study showed 14%, and a Danish study showed about 6%. And so these are just numbers that don't necessarily have a lot of relevance for folks, but I'd like to point out that when we did our study, the traditional way, which is you adjust for all the covariates that you have in your data, we did find that statistical association. So it was not like our study was biased to begin with to find no association.
So the cumulative evidence with the contribution of this analysis leaves what summary? Where is the science on this topic now, on this research question?
There is a consistent body of evidence now that is pointing towards no strong effect of acetaminophen on neurodevelopmental outcomes. Just in the last 3 weeks, in fact, our study was replicated in an entirely different population, a nationwide Japanese study with about 200,000 persons looked at this exact same question and also did a sibling analysis. Their use of acetaminophen in this population was roughly 40%. And they found the exact same thing that our Swedish study did, where there's an apparent statistical association initially, but it completely disappears when you do the sibling control analysis. And so the evidence is pointing a certain way that I think is going to be challenging for other studies to try and overcome.
So obstetric practice, the standard clinical practice for obstetric caregivers, is to evaluate and treat fever, especially during the first trimester, knowing the harms that are potentially associated with first trimester fever. So I do think there could be potential harms from avoiding needed acetaminophen use. And I think that we have to be careful to make sure that clinicians and patients they're caring for are able to follow best clinical care. So how can you help patients understand the conflicting messages that are currently in the news in terms of what their clinician is advising and best standard care for them?
I think you raise an excellent point. The conflicting messaging is going to be challenging to deal with. And I think it's fortunate that we have expert clinician bodies that have weighed in on this topic. For example, the Society for Maternal-Fetal Medicine, the American College of Obstetrics and Gynecology have weighed in on this topic and come to the same conclusion that basically that there's no strong evidence to support that this is a causal association. So I think where this leaves us with is, as before, any pregnant person who has questions about their health should be talking to their physician, and hopefully the physician as a point of contact will be able to cut through any confusion.
That's it for this episode. I'm Kate Schweitzer, Associate Managing Editor for JAMA Medical News. This episode was produced by Daniel Morrow at the JAMA Network. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com. Thanks for listening and join us again next time.
This content is protected by copyright by the American Medical Association with all rights reserved, including those for text and data mining, AI training, and similar technologies.